Well, welcome to the Harwood Museum of Art and our final community dialogue for the Mabel Dodge, Luhan and Company exhibition. These have been a great, we've had three of them, or this will be our third during the summer, and they've been great conversations. How many of you have been at any of the other ones? Excellent, so quite a few have been. This one is about collecting Hispano religious objects and the Santos that Mabel Dodge Luhan collected with Victor Goler and Malin Wilson Powell. Malin will introduce Victor, but I have the pleasure of introducing Malin. I am Juniper Manley, the Director of Development for the Harwood, and have been working with Malin for 4 years on this exhibition. She's been working much longer on it. She is, one of the important things about this exhibition was it's not only about the art that Mabel brought here, but more about the interchange. And Malin, through the objects she's chosen in this exhibition, has made that clear, hopefully, even if you're just walking through the exhibition. But the community dialogue is intended to really deepen that understanding and deepen that connection. So we hope you will enjoy this program today. Malin is an independent curator now, a historian and author. She was the curator of art after 1945 at the McNay Art Museum at San Antonio, the director of the Johnson Gallery for the UNM Art Museum, the curator of New Mexico Museum of Art in Santa Fe, among others, but different curatorial positions, and written broadly. So we're pleased to have Malin and Victor have a conversation today. Victor will do a presentation and Malin will help with that dialogue. And we'll take a break and then we'll open it up to you guys to have more conversation. I want to thank the New Mexico Humanities Council for their grant that has helped us to put this program on as well as make it free, and also the Charles Redd Center of Brigham Young University. Their support has made this possible. And if you would, there are surveys outside, and when you're done, if you wouldn't mind completing a survey, it really helps in, one, us knowing what we can do better and how you enjoyed it, but also for our funders. So thank you so much. And if you haven't turned off your cell phones, please do.
Hello, I'm Malin, obviously, and I just have to say that this exhibition would not have been possible without a lot of people. The Harwood has been a tremendous platform to take on this large exhibition. It is amazing, and it's so beautiful to me, and I'm going to be so sad when it leaves, but anyway. And it would not, Juniper was really a key person in bringing this exhibition here, so I'd like to acknowledge her today. Well, it's really my honor and pleasure to introduce Victor Goler, because he's just a master santero and a really great guy. And As you all know in Taos, this year he was given the Spanish Market in Santa Fe's highest award, the Master's Award for Lifetime Achievement, and he was a cover guy on our supplement in the newspaper. And this is after many years. He began showing in the Spanish Market in 1988, and since that time he's been given 24 previous awards. Now, he's a youthful 53 years old, and as you all know, he's a runner, if you've seen him running on the roads and around Taos. He apprenticed 4 decades ago, so for his 53 years, he's had 4 decades of work in as a santero and as a conservator. He worked in his family's conservation studio in Santa Fe, where he first learned to carve and to restore Santos. And when he moved to Taos in 1988, where his accomplishments, as I say, as an artist, conservator, coach for his daughter's running and soccer teams. He's also an international scholar, a curator, a board member. He's been a board member here at the Harwood, and as soon as this show goes down, you will again have Victor's wonderful installation up in the Hispanic Gallery. And he's also been a mentor who has shared generously with the community, and I know you're all aware of the work he's done pro bono for the Cuesta church being renovated. So since the 1990s, and specific in relationship to the Mabel collection, he has been a conservator of all the Santos at the Martinez Hacienda Museum, the Millicent Rogers Museum, the Kaus Foundation, and the Harwood, in addition to many other collections. Among them, the notable Larry Frank Major Santo collection, which was purchased by the state of New Mexico and is now at the Palace of the Governors in Santa Fe. That was 256. I think Larry Frank's book was called Kingdom of Saints, was it? Kingdom of Saints, yeah. So anyway, he was a well-known scholar, and I know Victor has his opinions that are very different from Larry Frank's. And so please welcome Victor.
Thank you, Malin. That was a very generous introduction, very nice of you. I'd like to take this opportunity to congratulate you on the Mabel Dodge Luhan show. It's been a great success. So wonderful job, as well as the Harwood staff that's assisted with all of this. I know they work very hard. And so thank you, guys, you know, as we come up here on the final stages of this show. What I'm going to talk to you about a little bit today is some of Mabel's collection that's being shown here at the show, but also I'm going to try to paint a picture of you of what Taos was like right around when she arrived and what the status of the New Mexico Santero was like really during that time. It was a very pivotal time. There was a lot of changes that were going on. Of course, we have the introduction of the railroad. We have modernism going on. And lots of things are really changing, in particular for the New Mexico Santero. I'd like to start really with a little bit of history. Going back to 1902, Virginia Kaus purchased her first retablo. She was the wife of E.I. Kaus. We have Virginia, the granddaughter, here today, which is a great honor when I... Virginia. In 1902, from Bert Phillips, right, who was running a curio shop. Bert Phillips was also one of the Taos Society artists. And so even before Mabel was really here, we see quite a bit of... In 1909, we see Frank Myers come into Taos, a good friend of Mabel Dodge Luhan's. Eventually, he also opens up... A merchant shop selling New Mexico religious work. In 1912, New Mexico turns into a state. By 1918, we see Mabel Dodge Luhan arrive to New Mexico. At this time, the local newspaper, La Revista de Taos, was written completely in Spanish. So she really arrived to a community that was largely Hispanic and Native American. When we look at the Santos, I was going to show you this, actually. This is one of the Kaus pieces, since I did mention Kaus, that he collected. And it's a wonderful collection if you do get a chance to ever go see it at the Kaus Foundation. But the Taos, the New Mexico Santero at the turn of the century was kind of winding down. And the pieces that Mabel Dodge collected were from about 1790s on until about the 1860s. After the 1860s, this is what we call the classical period. This is a time when the Santeros were very active here in New Mexico. There was a demand for their work because of the capillas and the churches that they were building. Back in those days, prior to the railroad, you had to make everything by hand. So if you wanted to make glue, you had to go out and shoot a rabbit and skin it and boil that glue and let it dehydrate and actually make glue out of it. If you wanted to make pigments, you had to crush minerals and plants. So it was very difficult. And at this point, they actually had workshops where they worked together to put all this into one place. Someone had to distill grain alcohol to make varnishes. You needed carpenters, blacksmiths to help you make tools, and so forth. But the most important part of this era is that these pieces were made strictly for devotional reasons. They were made for worship. They were made for veneration. They were not made for sale necessarily to the general public. Even though individuals purchased them, they really only did purchase them for devotional reasons. And so we're starting to see a little bit of decline during this production, really going into the late 1860s. Of course, we see the introduction of the railroad in the late 1880s, so we see prints that are coming in. We see plaster saints that are coming in, and so we're not seeing as much production of the piece of the older pieces or what we consider the classical period. Now, these are some of the pieces that Mabel Dodge collected. I want to talk about these a little bit, more so as to what they represent, because now, at this point, again, at the turn of the century, people are looking at these as historical pieces. They're looking at them in a very sort of aesthetic way, not really fully understanding what they're looking at 100%, at least from the religious point of view. Here we have in Our Lady of Sorrows. This is the Blessed Mother. This is a fresquise. He's one of the early santeros that worked along with Laguna and Moyeno. And they traveled all over northern New Mexico, really creating pieces for churches and capillas. Fresquise we can find his work in the Santuario de Chimayo. This particular piece, as I said, is Our Lady of Sorrows. We know that from the dagger that she has upon her side. This is her main sorrow, which is the crucifixion of Christ, right? The martyrdom of her son. If we look at the lower edge of this retablo, you'll see that there's like a small little burn mark, a little indentation on there. We used to think that this was candle damage, but it's actually purposely burned to create ashes for Ash Wednesday, so that you would create ashes from an actual santo for Ash Wednesday. Another piece here is Moyeno. You can find his work here at the St. Francis Church. He is also one of the earlier santeros that worked along, as I mentioned, with Laguna. This was definitely a workshop where they worked together. This is a later piece of Moyeno, and we can tell this by the fact that as he got older, he started to use less colors, and he became a lot more graphic with his strokes. You notice a straight line on the right side of his face. This is St. Geronimo, St. Jerome. He is a 4th century saint. He's often depicted with a lion, in the story where he pulls the thorn out of his paw and sort of domesticates his lion. One of the earlier pieces. This is another one of her pieces that is here in the show. This is Santiago Matamoros. This is St. James the Greater. He is an apostle, but during the Moorish conflict, he reappeared to help conquer the Moors during the Moorish and Spanish conflict. And that image was always brought here into the New World, into Mexico, and worked its way up into New Mexico. Always during battle, the Spanish would yell out Santiago as they would charge in. Kind of politically incorrect piece now. This is an interesting piece because, you know, we look at this, and I think from an aesthetic point of view, we see this and we're very attracted to it, when in fact it's actually kind of a powerful piece. This is El Rostro Divino, so this is the face of Christ. It's also known as Veronica or Veronica's Veil. It comes along during the sixth station of the cross, where Christ has already been condemned by Pontius Pilate, and he's working his way up to the crucifixion. At one point, this woman comes up to him, wipes his face with this cloth, and the image of the face is imprinted on the cloth. So this is a piece that you would worship. You know, we venerate the saints. We only worship God and Christ. So even though we might think of this as a pretty piece, it really represents something quite powerful. This is José Rafael Aragón. He was one of the most prolific santeros really to work in New Mexico. and was an amazing carver as well, that we can see here with this this Saint Michael, and you can really kind of see almost the Baroque influence from the drapery of the carvings and so forth. I just kind of threw these in because what's interesting about Mabel Dodge's collection is that she mainly collected retablos and not really too much of the three-dimensional pieces that we call bultos. So I wanted to show off a little bit of the bultos. But this is one of the bultos that she did collect. And it's not, I'm going to say it's not a great one in that, there's so much more elaborate. This piece is actually relatively simple. It has a plaster face, which is something that New Mexico Santeros didn't really do. The Laguna Santero did this. The Laguna, again, was one of the earlier 1790s through about 1810. He was not a particularly good carver himself, so instead of reducing wood, he built it up with gesso. And that's what what was done here. We don't really know if this is Laguna, but some of the squiggles down at the base make it look like it. This piece is relatively simple, and it has articulated arms, and what I believe is really kind of a removable head, so that you could dress it. You know, they often made outfits for a lot of the Santos, and that facilitated the actual dressing aspect of it. So, anyway. In 1907, just prior to Mabel's arrival, we have Jose Benito Ortega. This is kind of where the end of the classical period really stops. This particular artist really only worked until 1907. If you can imagine, Virginia Kaus was already here buying Santos. She could have bought one from this guy, in a contemporary way. But we're seeing the winding down of these classical guys, the guys that used the watercolors, the natural pigments, made everything by hand. But the demand was really, really decreasing. And so right around this time, we really almost see a stop to it, to the tradition of making Santos. But the people that are carrying it on are the penitentes. And so the penitentes, for those of you that don't know who they are, it's a religious group that's part of the Catholic Church that has existed here in New Mexico for many years. They were the ones really that were out in the outposts. You know, there was really only one church in Española. The priests couldn't really make it to all the outlying communities. And so there was moradas. These moradas are where these penitentes really sort of practice their religion, and they believe in the passion of Christ more than anything. And so they believe in the stations of the cross that I just mentioned. And so a lot of the images that you might find of the penitentes is of Christ on the column or Christ crucified, which is what we see here. In this case, we see a difference in pigments now because of the introduction of enamels. And so it's a lot easier for some of these santeros to create pieces. The penitente movement worked all its way up into southern Colorado, deep into the Huerfano Valley, Gardner, Walsenburg, and they kept the tradition of Santo making alive specifically for the purpose of worship. Notice that the color on this particular figure, the penitentes generally make their pieces very bloody, very painful. This is the Abiquiu Santero. We don't really know his true name. We just name him because of the area that he worked in. But notice sort of the color of the skin. So what they were trying to do here is really place Christ right at that moment of death, of his passing. This is what is known as a blue Cristo. So his blood has already drained, and he's really, really, really close to dying. This is another Penitente Santero, Antonio Herrera. There's a Miguel Herrera. I mean, there's quite a few others that work their way up the front range. Now, going into the 1920s, Mabel has influenced a number of artists to come to New Mexico. There's such artists as Dasberg. There was quite a few that got involved in collecting the Santos. Mary Austin was one of them. Frank Applegate was another one. These individuals now going into the 1920s are very interested in collecting, and they're seeing that these pieces are being sold a little too much, a little too fast through these curio places. And so they really want to start to research and start to collect. And so Applegate was one of these very instrumental people. He did make some of the Santos, and it just so happened that I had a few of these images, so I thought it'd be fun to show him. He was a potter originally, but he collected quite a bit. And one of the things that Applegate did to really help was that he documented everything. So he had a good provenance, and he had oral history that he was writing down. Also in the 1920s, and so, you know, because of that, we do see massive collecting going on during the 1920s. This is the Morada of Larry Frank, which we mentioned earlier, Malin mentioned earlier. His collection is at the Palace of the Governors. I had the opportunity to work for Larry for 20 years, and I actually got to play with this collection. You know, here's where I sort of really got the foundation for my education of Santos, and we would go in here and we'd be able to pull them all apart, and not apart, but put them together. And since none of these pieces are signed, the only way to really tell who created them is through specific artistic characteristics that they each have. So Larry didn't start collecting till later, but this is pretty much what, you know, Applegate's house looked like, or, you know, we have... Katie Wells was also a major collector. As I mentioned, Dossberg was an extremely aggressive collector. And they were doing it for the sake of really trying to really preserve what they now call an art form. So now we've gone from Santos for worship to a cultural sort of art form. In 1925, Applegate, along with Mary Austin, who was influenced by Bemuel Dodge, start the Spanish Colonial Art Society. This is a society where they are sort of aggressively collecting and trying to gather information for the sake of preservation. At that same time, we start to see an influence on other artists, on other carvers. This is Jose Dolores Lopez. They are known as he sort of started what is known as the Cordova Carvers today in the town of Cordova, New Mexico, and there's generations of them that work up until this day. What's important about this step is that now we're starting to see Santos that are being created for sale, not necessarily for devotional reasons only. So this is a pretty drastic change now. And some of that does create tension with the Hispanic community. And there's already been tension that's been created because of almost the gobbling up of the Santos during that time period, because there was a lot of people that were collecting. I'm only just naming a few of the people that really were very instrumental. So, you know, so we're working through the 20s, and somewhere around the latter part of the 1920s, we see the introduction of the word santero. So before that, we really don't see this word in any of the church records. Prior to this, we see pintores, we see escultores. So the word santero was maybe introduced somewhere around there in the 1930s to really help identify these artists. The mission of the Spanish Colonial Art Society was to really encourage the local community to continue to do their cultural art form. So not only the carving of Santos, but the weaving, the furniture making, the blacksmithing, the culture embroidery, tinsmith, or the poor man's gold, which is the straw applique. If you were to use the word santero anywhere else other than New Mexico, you will get a completely different reaction, especially if you use this word in Latin American or the Caribbean, and I can explain that later, but only here in New Mexico can you do that. By 1930s, and I'm only taking this to the 60s, by 1930s we see the introduction of the WPA era. And so now we're seeing efforts by the government to really help support some of the local artists. There were some woodworking shops here in Taos, and so things are really starting to shift for the New Mexico Santero and the New Mexico arts. They're really starting to be produced more for sale to the general public, to supply schools when we're talking about furniture and public buildings and so forth. 1931, Frank Apple, Applegate actually dies, which was somewhat shocking. He had amassed quite a big collection, and it was purchased by Bemis, Alice Bemis, who started the Taylor Museum, which is the Colorado Springs Fine Arts Center, which opened its doors in 1936. Now, that museum was really at the forefront of developing all the scholarly work on these types of pieces, and was very, very aggressively collecting here in New Mexico, with some resentment from the New Mexicans at that time, because they felt that all these pieces were being taken out of the state and across the border. Remember that before 1912, there were no borders. You know. Also in the 1930s, such artists as Doss, Berg, and Katie Wells were also avid collectors. Patrocino Barella comes into the scene. He is our famous Santero. This is actually Nicodemus, which is the son of José Dolores López, that continued to go on with his work. We have artists such as Juan Amadeo Sanchez, that was actually replicating work in the 1930s in order to preserve some of the styles and the techniques that had been used a long time ago. And as I had mentioned, we had started, Patrocino Barella comes into the scene with a very modernistic look to his work, as well as we had seen with the Dolores López pieces. And he's quickly gathering national acclaim. By the 1940, the first book is written. By 1943, the first book, one of the first books, one of the books that was more well written with some scholarly efforts. What had happened was is that the Applegate collection went to the Taylor Museum also, so we have more pieces going out of New Mexico. As well, by the 1940s, we see other artists such as Celso Gallegos, who comes into play. We also see Leo Salazar, who comes into play, who started kind of the cedar carvers of Taos. We also see the negotiation start for the Talpa Chapel. Now, this is a chapel that was in Talpa, the Duran Chapel. It was in disrepair and falling apart, and it took almost about 10 years to sort of work out the negotiations. There were people like Dossberg and Gamim, who was the architect out of Santa Fe, who really wanted to preserve it here in New Mexico as a national sort of monument. The Duran family that owned it resisted. There was still a lot of sort of animosity between, the Hispanic communities and the Anglos coming in and buying a lot of these artworks. And it was a very sort of contentious negotiation. So there was groups that were here, they wanted to save it here, but there was other people like the Taylor Museum that really, really wanted that altar. By the 1950s, we see the sale of the chapel to Larry Garnett, and it ends up going to Colorado Springs. This sort of raises a little bit of a ruckus again here in New Mexico, but then quickly dissipates. There was always that argument, why should all these pieces end up in Colorado? But in fact, Colorado does have its own history of saint makers that we mentioned earlier, with all their penitentes really working their way up into the southern part of Colorado. Then going into the 1950s, in 1951, the Spanish Colonial Art Society launches its first Spanish market, which continues to this day, which I've been a member of for 29 years, in order to help promote the local arts and to help a lot of the artists have a venue for them to sell. One of the things that Leandro's Duran's daughter, who was one of the ones who sold the chapel, stated in her book, the dream of traditional life was replaced by reality. And so the pieces were finally sold. Not until 1953 do we see the Museum of International Folk Art open its doors in Santa Fe. And so now, finally, we're getting some collecting here in New Mexico. Again, the Spanish Colonial Art Society was creating its collection. There was artists that were donating their collections, also like Katie Wells, Dawsberg, obviously. When did Mabel Dodge donate her collection, Malin, to the Harwood? 1925. So, wow, yeah, so that was pretty early on. That was pretty early on. So now we're down to the final decade before Mabel Dodge passes away in 1962. We go into the 1960s. We have the people that are still working, such as Amadeo Sanchez, George Lopez, who is also one of the sons of Jose Dolores Lopez. George Lopez goes on to have national acclaim. Patrocinio Barella is still working and receiving national acclaim, and other artists that are emerging, such as Enrique Rendon, are creating pieces and selling them for non-devotional reasons, but more for artistic reasons. This is Our Lady of Guadalupe, La Reina. She is depicted here with Juan Diego, who is the native in Mexico that she appeared to for the first time. He eventually does become a saint and was canonized maybe 6-7 years ago. Notice the dark skin on this particular piece. You know, it's just sort of reflects the native community of Mexico really at that time. Also, we see a book written, Saints in the Valley, one of the first books written by Hispanic, by Jose Espinosa. At the beginning of that book, in the foreword, Fray Angelico Chavez, who is a Franciscan priest, he is a genealogist, a historian, a very well-respected individual in New Mexico, really a New Mexico treasure, has this to say about the New Mexico, the continuation of the making of New Mexico Santos. Any attempt to reproduce these Santos now, even by native New Mexicans, or to revive similar carving as an art, is not only a sin against art itself, but a mockery in its best result. Ouch. I understand. and I sympathize with what he's saying. He was born in 1912 in Mountain Air, New Mexico. He grew up with the old ways. He was a priest. And so for him to see these pieces go from what he always knew and recognized as pieces made strictly for devotion and prayer and veneration and worship, he can't stand to see what was really happening. But all the wheels were already in motion by then. By 1960, you know, by 1959, Larry Frank had started collecting, and we see the continuation. You know, Spanish Market's already been around now for 10 years, helping local artists continue to move their work. And so the movement has begun. So, you know, we decide whether it's appropriate or not. But that is the end of the lecture, end of the discussion. I want to thank you for listening to me, and thank you very much, heartfelt thank you for just coming. And supporting the show.
Okay, so you can all think of your questions. I project pretty well. I think you do too. So, but before we go on to our discussion and questions, I would like you to clear up why you can't use the word Santero.
Well, because in a... see, I knew I was guaranteed a question when I said that. In Latin America, in particular in the Caribbean, a santero is a completely different person. It's more like a curandero here, but they really combine African beliefs and African effigies with Catholic effigies and Catholic beliefs. They're healers, but they can also mix it with voodoo. You know, it's a whole range of things, and it means something completely different than what a santero is here. So it can be shocking, because you know? They're not necessarily considered, you know, super friendly. I don't think I don't know a lot about the santero world, you know, in the Caribbean. But I know that there's a lot of myth that's associated with it. But it is witchcraft, there is voodoo, there's healing, there's all these things that are combined.
Thank you. One of the things when putting together this show, and you and I talked about this, the exhibition of Mabel's 85 Santos that came, her collection that came to the Harwood, came after she exhibited them in New York City. She sent them to New York City. They were first collected when she got here. Within weeks, people were bringing Santos to her doors to see if she would buy them. And of course, within 2 weeks, Andrew Dasburg was here. He was a modernist. He saw them as pure, fantastic, bold design. Exactly, you know, what Victor was talking about. And she wrote a pamphlet to go along with this exhibition in New York. And it was really, talk about politically incorrect. If you read this pamphlet today, I do have the script. We did not put it up in the wall in the exhibition because in a way it's so horrifying. She talked about the poverty of how the Hispano culture had not advanced at all since it had come to the New World. And how they weren't artists, and she says it multiple times. And she'll say they were not artists. They were quite untrained. They set themselves to work to make their idols. She was using language that was insulting, difficult, and I really had to puzzle over this, putting together the exhibition. And I realized exactly what Victor said. This was a Spanish-speaking town. By 1938, only 93%, all 93% of the people spoke Spanish as a first language here. And Mabel didn't speak Spanish. And as a Victorian child who was reacting to her upbringing, and this, because she went to an Episcopal girls' school, she was all organized religion. So she could not understand a life of devotion. She simply couldn't. I think she couldn't understand that. And so I don't know. Do you want to say anything about that?
Well, I know that just viewing collectors. And the reasons why they collect, and I'll speak a little bit about Larry Frank, because that's how he viewed the saints. He collected them because he was enamored with the devotional work in Europe initially when he was in the Navy. He really liked those pieces, but they were all, you know, gone. And a trip to New Mexico, he was exposed to the devotional arts and became immediately enamored and moved here, bought a morada, and started collecting. But he viewed his pieces strictly aesthetically. And I would go to his lectures, and I would listen to him speak, and it was hard because he looked at them in squiggles and lines and bold colors, as you mentioned, never really fully understanding what the pieces meant and what they meant to the people of New Mexico. You know, there's a very close association with the saints and really all over Latin America in such a close way that, you know, sometimes the Archbishop reprimands us because we almost worship the saints, and you're not supposed to. You're supposed to venerate them. But there's such a huge part of everyday life for the Hispanic community. You would take out your San Isidro out into the fields for agriculture. He's the patron saint of laborers. And so for the sake of good crops, you would light candles and say prayers to this particular saint. And so it was very much a part of everyday life. And I think that that's one of the things that caused some tension was that it wasn't really fully understood what these pieces represented.
On the formal level, of course, you could see in the galleries how much they inspired the artists. how beautifully they reacted to them. But myself, having been raised Catholic, I always felt that I related to the Santos more on their attributes, their saintly attributes and what they were doing. But so I think this is but it was very, people in Taos heard about what Mabel wrote for the New York exhibition. And they were so up in arms. There was such a big backlash. That is why she gave her collection to the Harwood. And so, in a way, that's kind of an ironic way to get a collection. You know, a certain kind of racism is going on, and that's why today we have the ability to see these things in both ways. I'm hoping that through the exhibition you could see them in both ways, that they're appreciated for both things. So I was really interested in the fact that that the newspaper was in Spanish when Mabel came, that everybody spoke Spanish, including the people from Taos Pueblo, and that Mabel, in a way, I realized in a way she was much more isolated than I had thought she was. So, and it was only certain artists who came, John Collier and John Collier Jr., who lived in Talpa, and who really integrated themselves into the Spanish community here, Spanish-speaking community. So studying the relationship of Mabel and the community at that time and how small Taos was and how she, her own isolation would have been, because when in the exhibition you'll see an Ufer painting of Native Americans building her house. It wasn't Hispanos building her house. The people who worked in her house were all Native American. And so, you know, we see Mabel connected to this whole world, and yet because of her own prejudices, she was not integrated into the Catholic Hispano community. It was only other artists who came and appreciated them that were integrated into that community.
Yeah, I mean, like Frank Myers, you know, who was a great friend of hers, you know, was actually a pretty avid dealer and collector. I'd mentioned Dossberg, another artist who was a major collector. Applegate was a major collector. All these artists were the ones that were really interested in the devotional arts. You know, Katie Wells also amassed a huge collection. All people that Mabel had influenced, but it was artists that really got it, sort of everything generated as far as documenting and collecting for the sake of preservation, and influencing Hispano artists in New Mexico to continue the tradition.
So, does anybody want to ask us a question?
My mind's kind of blown. Hearing that about her, because she was bringing artists here, wasn't she? She was actually bringing artists here, and I would think that as a collector, she would have studied art history. You know,
no.
Not well, maybe. I mean, she's so involved. There was nothing to study,
as far as the New Mexico pieces. There was at that point, there was no academic. They were just learning. You know,
sure. But I mean, if she had actually a lot of collectors, because she had so much. Exposure to other artists too, that, you know, maybe she read a little art history and understood about Byzantine art, or, you know, something that would enlighten her. It's just, I'm just like, my mind's just a little blown hearing that, because I had a totally different picture in my head of what she was like, because I didn't, you know, really looked at the show and read everything, so I'm just...
She was definitely more enamored with the Native American community than the Hispanic community.
Well,
Well, I mean, she fell in love with Tony, you know, and she was deeply associated with that community, and then she was very politically active in the Burson Bill and all of these other things to do with Native Americans. And Tony would go back with her to New York, but in terms of the Hispanic community, it was the other artists like Dosper and Katie Wells that were really appreciating the Native Americans. She bought these Santos that were brought to her door because she was also trained, in a sense, in modernism. Mm-hmm. And that was, when she was living in Florence, she went to only through high school. And women of her generation in Buffalo, she was, you know, from a wealthy banking family, they were raised to be wives. They weren't raised to be art historians. And so she, you know, when she went to Europe, she wanted to recreate the Renaissance, but most of her associates were modernists. And so they were, this is after what was called the Age of Reason, the Age of Enlightenment, scientific thinking, a whole coming of secularism. And you have to realize that New Mexico was the farthest outpost of Mexico or New Spain, and it was settled before that scientific age. And so the entire history of the religious history of people come here was one of complete devotion. And the calendar was all on the saint, about the saints' days. The feast days of the saints. That's what people made their own music. They made their own paints, glue. They add their own retablos to paint it on. So everything was done by hand. And it was very far away from Mexico City. It was how many months did it take to get here?
Extremely isolated, especially when you think of all the smaller communities outside of Taos proper. I mean, Taos was a relatively popular place, but I mean, the railroad never really reached here, so it still took a long time, and it wasn't a big place. I think in 1921, the population of Santa Fe was 7,300, you know, which is probably what the town of Taos is now. I think it's more than 8,000 proper town of Taos. But when you include all the other outlying communities, like, you know, El Prado was a community, Arroyo Hondo was a community, Arroyo Seco was a community, all these places were far away from each other. Even Talpa and Ranchos, which is really, they're only a couple of miles apart, it still took a while, you know, and so, yeah, extreme isolation, you know, for New Mexico for a very, very long time.
Well, and again, to contrast that with the Native American community, Taos Pueblo was, even though it was a small population, was a cosmopolitan place because it always was a trading center. And people came from the Nez Pierce, Oklahoma, California, all the way up from Central America. So you maybe had, I don't know, you know, there were 500 different native languages in the U.S., continental U.S. So maybe you had 100 different languages meeting at Taos Pueblo, whereas the Hispanic communities were all Spanish-speaking, and they were all part of the Catholicism. No, it was united in that way. So you have to sort of think of these things, like you say, kind of surprising to think of that time in history and how remote it, New Mexico was for so long. Yes, sir.
I was wondering why neither of you have mentioned E. Boyd and her contributions.
She came later, so, you know, and she used a lot of the foundation of the information that was gathered by the Taylor Museum and some of the oral history from Applegate and stuff. And I think she published her book in 73. Definitely one of the best
reads, if you're really looking at a very well-rounded scholarly effort, E. Boyd and Will Roth were the two that really wrote very well about the cultural arts of New Mexico. And the only reason I didn't mention her is because she came after Mabel Dodge. So I was just trying to stay within the realm of Mabel's time here in Taos. So I think the E. Boyd's book was in 1973 that it may have come out. I'm not exactly sure.
She was a friend of Katie Wells.
Yeah, she was still around and definitely collecting information and stuff. But like I said, the only reason I didn't mention her was because she printed later. You know, so I just went to up to 1960 and the information that was available up to that time. I mean, there's other people such as like Elmer Shoup, who was a major picker, collector, you know, that I didn't really quite mention. I'm sure that he probably, you know, supplied maybe Mabel with pieces. He certainly supplied, again, the Taylor Museum. There's a lot of pieces that are, the provenance goes back to Elmer Shoup. Could write a whole story, you know, on him. There's people I didn't mention because this is actually such a rich area of information, a really rich time, and there's so many players involved, right? There's the Harvey Company, there's quite a few, you know, people that were around this time. I was trying to, again, focus on the people that Mabel had influenced directly.
Well, I think one of the interesting things about Dasburg, and Dasburg started a trading post in Santa Fe, which would have been right across from the La Fonda Hotel. And this was done with Mabel's son and Nordfeld, and I'm trying to remember who else was, but there were a number of Santa Fe Taos people, and it sold both Native American and Hispano things. So that was unusual, but it also again shows the, in a sense, the, they call them visitor artists, in a sense, prejudice of putting all the other category together, the exotic, in one place. So anyway, just, yes.
So the beginning of the slide presentation, you had a couple of retablos side by side, unrestored and restored. And I'm curious about Mabel's collection when it came to the Harwood. Is it as we see them now, which is in spectacularly pristine condition looking to me? Do you know anything about
Yeah,
them?
No, I, you know, they were. I assessed these pieces a long time ago. I'm gonna say back in the 90s originally. They're pretty much as they are. I don't think I really cleaned any. The first image that you saw earlier is from the Kaus Foundation. With those particular pieces, they had been varnished and sort of re-varnished a number of times. And what happens in New Mexico, and with a lot of New Mexican pieces, is that they used a very rustic varnish, generally made out of pinon sap and some sort of grain alcohol. And this happened with varnishes in Europe as well during the 1800s. And that is that they turn yellow with time. But in particular, pinon sap, within 30 years, there's quite a bit of difference. Within 50 years, there's even more. What you saw was over 100 years, because that was a fresquise. But it had been something that had been re-varnished a number of times, probably with shellac, you know, because, again, we're seeing the introduction of varnishes being brought in by the railroad, and so they, you know, they were using what they had to make them look a little bit better. So cleaning them is, you know, as you can see, it makes a big difference. But it's something that you know, that you, when I work for museums, really the attitude is more towards conservation, and so you preserve what is there. You don't remove the old varnishes. You don't really add anything structurally, and then you get into restoration where you're maybe cleaning, you know. But cleaning's always, you know, it's one of those things that can be kind of tricky. I don't know if you remember the Sistine Chapel when it was cleaned many years ago. There was a big uproar that it was too clean, and so it's kind of hard, to get in between there. But usually for museums, you know, it's conservation. versus restoration for some. But in the case of those of the Kaus retabula, it was so dark that you really, really, you know, couldn't see it.
Yes.
Going back to the bad feelings between Hispanics and collectors, unfortunately, greed got into the way, not in all cases, but some of these religious objects were stolen from moradas and from different homes and then sold to collectors. Oh. And they were never, some of these collectors never asked where these pieces came from. You know, and so there's a lot of bad feeling there. There are some Santos that are have been removed from the moradas and so on and kept in people's homes. Nobody knows about it, you know, which is good. Now, another thing is that some of these pieces, like for example, the Reredo from Our Lady of Mount Carmel in Llano Quemado, the people needed money to restore the roof. They took out this, and Applegate found out right away and went and got it. And I guess it's good because it's preserved. Otherwise, it would, by now, probably wouldn't exist.
Yeah, that's the tension that exists to this day.
It is a cultural memory because it goes
back. It is. And it was hard to, you know, to relinquish. You know, I had that quote, the Duran granddaughter, how she had to succumb to reality. They're the ones that sold it in the end. You know, there was people that were trying to preserve it and trying to help them out, but they still resisted. There was because of that mistrust and that tension that existed. You know,
it's a huge problem in our museum collections all over the world. You know, the Greeks are still trying to get the Elgin marbles back. And the argument from a lot of museums are, well, they would have been destroyed in the wars, you know. So I guess we have to be grateful for what we can see. And that's...
You had a question here first.
I'm curious, Victor, as times change, when Catholic buyers purchase from you a retablo or bolto, are they doing it primarily, do you think, for using it primarily for aesthetic appreciation or for devotional? Do they put it in chapels or in
devotional areas? Well, it's a variety of reasons that the people collect today, not only my work, but other contemporary Santeros. We can say that a lot of it is a certain amount of aesthetic appeal. There's plenty of people that are very religious, very devout, that buy them, and then there's just kind of the spiritual crowd, so that you have your own connection to a specific saint, and it could be your profession, it could be something that you like, and it's something that's a little bit more contemporary, and that touches more on, you know, sort of a younger generation. So, for example, if you're a cyclist, you might want a Madonna de Gisalo, you know, that you light a candle to and you say a prayer to, or if you're a fisherman, you might want a Saint Andrew. And that you light a candle to and you say maybe your own personal prayer doesn't have to be necessarily Catholic. And then, you know, we do plenty of Catholic work. I just, you know, finished up with the altar screen at the Cuesta the church, you know, and so that piece was made only for devotional reasons, you know, and not really for sale as an aesthetic piece. And so the collection range has really broadened, you know, to why people collect.
Yes, back in the 1970s, there was a big rash of, as she was saying, thefts and breaking into moradas and other places, and Santos and all this being taken out, and there was an extensive market, almost like a black market going on for all of that too. In the early 1970s, I was commissioned to go around the state and document just about every Santo we could all around, myself and Barry Lopez and some other people to the museum in Mexico back then. I think that it was one of the best jobs I ever had, I know for sure, getting to every place around, homes and churches, and as far as possible, every Santo we could see, we would identify and, you know, measure and document and photograph. I think that whole documentation still exists somewhere.
Was that for the Archdiocese, or?
No, this was, it was through, it might have been, but it was the actual commission and paid us and all were with the state of the Museum of New Mexico. I think it's somewhere over there yet to be tracked down. But there was a lot of that going on, and there still is. If you go to, I think a lot of people don't know, but if you go to the Palace of the Governors now to see the Larry Frank exhibition there, it was like this or like this, should the state buy it or not, and you know, there was a lot of smoothing out that had to be done between the community and the collector's site. When this Tesoros de Devoción was formally installed in 2008, a number of the Brotherhood members of various of the Moradas went to Palace of the Governors on that day and essentially held a prayer, a commendation kind of service for that exposition there. I composed the blessing prayer and for that, which is still there. That's a part of the exposition that probably people don't really are not really that aware of. But my point is that it's an exposition of the devotion, the Tesoros de Devoción. And many, many people go to see it. But what people do not realize is that kind of underlying the exhibit itself, there continues to be our own connection with all the pieces that are there in prayer and in devotion. So that is there.
Yep.
And it's in
black. That's great.
And the same applies to many of the other collections. I know that personally, I'm very, very much committed to helping to take care of the collection at the Martinez Hacienda, for example. And I've seen the Taylor Museum. I'm not sure what's happened to that collection now. Some say it's all in the basement.
It's back out. Mm-hmm. Yeah, the top off altar screen is on display, and it's back out. Yeah, a lot of it is back out. I mean, they have a huge collection.
So just to sum up, my point here is that to everyone here and anybody listening, this matter of our community feeling or our devotion to these pieces, whether many of them are scattered about here and there or in collections out there in all, yet we continue to have that unbroken relationship, devotional relationship with them. And I know we have a wonderful present day Santeros, some of our geographers here today as well, continue to show that. But it's always there.
Yeah, well said. I agree with that. Yeah. You know, I think that's really what, you know, what really empowers and connects a lot of the contemporary Santeros working in New Mexico today. You know, it's that tradition, it's that commitment that they've always had with the Santos. Yes, sir.
As an example, if you notice, with all the retablos, they have a border on them. And this border was to contain the divine. The devotion was so deep that they actually thought that they could taste the divine within that border.
Within the border.
So going back to the burning down underneath, mm-hmm. that was also divine too.
Mm-hmm.
So the ashes were considered divine too.
Yes, of course.
And they had that miracle of hearing you, whatever they use those ashes for.
Very much so.
You know, also the people see the bloody crucifixes and so on, and are kind of, that was part of our life. If our lives, the lives of our ancestors were so difficult, extremely, you know, and with braids from the Comanches and the Apaches and so on, you know, life was just very difficult. Very. And that's portrayed in the samples.
Oh, I know. Life was very difficult here with every...
Yeah, poverty, extreme poverty, hunger.
Mm-hmm. I mean, there's this study that I read in preparation for this exhibition by a man named George Sanchez. He wrote it in 1938. It's called Forgotten People, A Study of New Mexicans. And it was, he was a professor of education, and he, as I said, 93% of children were Spanish speaking in 1938 when he did his study. And there were no Spanish speaking teachers in the public schools.
That's my case.
Yeah. I mean, it's just, it's so recent in terms of history. Yeah. That there were no, so the language of, so he talks about the overwhelming isolation, and so he says the language, customs, and technology were those of 16th century Spain. He had to become self-sufficient in his way, having little trust in innovation, no notions of the changing civilizations. The finer things in life were religion, folk music, drama, and fiestas. So I have a friend, you may know, he's an art critic, and he's from Texas, and his name's Dave Hickey. He's spoken here before, but he's from Texas, and he always said, well, if Mexico, as Texas had stayed Mexico, we would have had a lot more fiestas. Who else would like any more questions? Krista.
Victor, hi. Yeah, so I know your talk only went up to 1960, but I'm sitting here wondering if you have a little history, or even maybe before 1960, where there was ever any evidence of women creating that devotional
there, there were. They were just getting started, and I almost put them in. The reason I didn't, because I've used them in other lectures here in Taos, and I didn't want to be repetitive with some of my imagery. But there's the female carvers really maybe started to come into play right around then. The two that were the most important were Gloria Lopez and Sabinita Ortiz, who are both Cordova carvers, so they're descendants of Jose Dolores Lopez and his generations, and they work to this day. But they're getting older, you know. And interestingly enough, I was doing a little bit of research this year at Spanish Market because I was interested in, specifically in the female carvers and who were really sort of active right now. There was never really that many that worked early on. But there's Marie Romero Cash, who probably started in the 70s. There's Rhonda Crespin, who I think started in the 80s. We now have Lori Garcia, who's from Peñasco.
Yeah.
There's about seven altogether that are still working today, but the two earliest ones are the two Cordova carvers that I just mentioned.
And what year for those?
Well, they're still alive, but I think that Sabinita was born in like 38, and Gloria Lopez was like in 1943 or something. And they're still active. Yeah. But there's no one else within the Cordova carvers females that are up and coming. You know, at least that's what I found out this summer. What we're seeing with some of the younger generation of Santero specifically, I'm not going to talk about all the cultural arts because some of them do better than others, the weaving, the others that are part of it, is that we have a lot of youth artists, you know, for example, going into Spanish Market, and they're great. They make these really wonderful things that, you know, their minds are so free and not quite as
corrupt and restricted as ours when we get older. But when they transition into the adult category at 18, you know, they're going off to college, they're trying to find a job, and so we're not really seeing often, you know, a big influx of artists kind of coming in from the youth, you know, and so there's a bit of a disconnect there. And then they come back, or, you know, they have a regular job, and the Spanish market may be their only show, or, you know, they carve on weekends and stuff like that. There's not a lot that are full time, you know, that are completely committed. It's really, really hard to survive as an artist. For any of you, you know, that are out there as artists, I became an artist when I was 23, so I didn't fully understand the economic diversity. Stuck with it.
But you were a teenager when you started doing conservation.
I did. No, I was definitely working in my uncle's studios by the time I was 11. I was carving by the time I was 13. In high school, I was already carving saints and painting retablos strictly for friends and family as gifts.
For my part, anyway, I just want to express my own personal appreciation to you, Victor, and both of you, and put this on here, very informative and so forth. I will just once again state to everybody here that this is all still very much alive. It's very much alive. We can go to see the exhibits and the collections and all this here and there, but it's very much alive because the religious devotion of the area here is still. It's historical, it's rooted, and it's living right now in producing works of art, devotional art, or if you want to call it that, continues the singing, the societies, the brotherhoods. These things are all very, very much alive right now. So for people who want to learn more about our area, you're welcome to talk people who are from the area and visit some of those places that are taking care of places. I think they take good care of them. I know they do at Millicent Rogers Museum. I know we do our best to do that at the Martinez Hacienda and other places around like that. But it's very, very much alive, very much a part of our community. Yeah.
Okay. You know, one of the things that, as you say, you know, there's 400 years, you know, really worth of history in the devotional arts. But one thing that's really unique and you know, happens quite a bit here in Taos is that we do have, you know, quite a few penitentes, quite a few morales. And if you ever have the opportunity during Holy Week to really participate in some of these processions and the singing of the alabados and the encuentros, it's really a wonderful experience. And the penitentes were really instrumental in keeping the education alive. When the priests could make it to all the little communities, the penitentes were leaders of the communities. They were important people, and they really kept with those alabados. They kept the education going. But it's really a very sort of heartfelt ceremonies and things. If you do get to a chance to participate with the penitentes. You know, normally you're not allowed into the morales, but during Holy Week you can see a lot of different functions in different morales here in Seco or in Talpa, and it's a nice experience.
How many, I've always been curious about what the relationship was between what was in terms of the penitentes and what was in people's homes, Santos and
Well, I know that some of the penitentes would allow you, you know, you can take a santo home, you know, for a while, you know, and take care of it, and then you bring it back. And I'm not exactly sure. You might
for security reasons.
For security reasons,
right.
Primarily.
A lot of the morales were being vandalized, so a lot of these were taken home.
Yeah, but I know they do that. They do that to this day, because, you know, I was in the
any of the pieces in her collection from that Morada. It's no longer active.
Is that the one skipped? Yeah. Where's skipped?
Yeah.
You know that skipped? You know that.
It transferred out of the museums a number of years ago, the Town Historic Museum, that had purchased it back in the early 60s, I believe. And it was kept up by the museums. There were, at that point in time, there were only two surviving members, Mr. Martinez and Mr. Panorio. And they sold it. And I don't know, it's probably when Liz and I were living in Oregon that it was transferred to the Archdiocese. And I know that there are members of the Hermanos who are you know, diligently trying to get the funds and to keep it up and in repair. And like many of the historic buildings, it's just not easy. And the Archdiocese has, to my knowledge, not really participated with any funding to provide something.
Well, you know, the Cuesta Church was obviously an example of that, right?
Well, let me say on that, or rather, it's on a good track.
Is it? That's good.
Okay, good. Well, if you don't have any more questions,
glad you're in the crowd.
I think Victor or I would be happy to talk to you for a little bit after this if you have a personal, direct question for us. So thank you for coming.